And the leading theory that I learned at that point was that I had a birth defect. And this birth defect was that in utero, my mind was washed with the wrong hormones. And therefore, I had the brain of a woman and I was trapped in a male body. I scheduled a surgery for a penile inversion. It was actually the surgery to create a man-made artificial vagina. The surgery didn't go well.
Hi, I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute, an interfaith international coalition to defend the family. Marriage, family, human sexuality, all these issues are in a state of confusion and chaos. At the Ruth Institute, we bring you solid scientific information and first-person stories to help you make sense of a world that's lost its mind. So we welcome you back to reality. My guest today is Billy Burleigh, who has had a very poignant journey with the gender ideology. You can read more about him and his story in the show notes below. And as you're getting settled back into the world of common sense and sound thinking, be sure to hit the little subscribe button below and then hit the little bell to get notifications of our newest uploads. And keep your finger on that share button because you're going to want to share this video with friends and family. Welcome to the Dr. J Show and welcome back to reality. Billy Burleigh, thank you so much for being my guest today.
Good morning, Dr. Morris, and thank you for having me. It's such an honor to be speaking with you this morning.
Well, thank you very much. You know, you have an interesting story. And so if you don't mind, I'd like you to kind of start with at the end and tell people how you are today, because if people hear your story, they may be freaked out over certain parts of it. So tell people kind of where things stand with your life today, Billy, just so people know where this story ends.
You know, I'd love to. And just to start off, you know, I've given my life over to God, and just a quick prayer, and that we give thanks to you, God, and we ask for a hedge protection around us and the electronics. And just thank you, Jesus. So, you know, just starting off where I am today, God is just such a very important part of my life. I am married to a beautiful lady, have been for about 11 years now. I have two daughters. They're actually my stepdaughters, but I count them as my daughters because their father passed in 2007. So I've had the opportunity to get very close to them and just to love them as my own. Also have a son-in-law, my oldest daughter and son-in-law, they're in the Navy and they just got shipped back, returned to the States. They were serving overseas. So I'm thankful for that. I have another daughter who's a nurse up in Twin Falls, Idaho.
Well, that's great. That's great. So you've landed on your feet more or less with the help of God's grace, you've landed on your feet.
I have very much so.
Yeah. So let's go back to the beginning then. This is a story of gender ideology and gender confusion. What made you think that you might be a trans person, Billy? Tell us a little bit about when those thoughts started coming to your mind.
Dr. Morris, it was back when I was in around first grade.
First grade?
Around first grade.
Wow.
I was actually standing in our school parking lot because at our elementary school, all of the kids gathered in the front parking lot. When the first bell rang, we all lined up. And I remembered standing there, looking around and looking at the kids, wondering, where do I belong? And the thought came into my mind, God made a mistake. I'm a girl. And it was a very strange thought. I rejected it because my body parts and everything about me said I was male. But it was a reoccurring thought that started coming into my mind more frequently. And especially when I was idle or getting ready to go to bed. I was a very skinny kid. I had a speech impediment. I had learning difficulties. And I was very unathletic. So truly, I did not fit in with the boys very well. But it seemed like I would be a better fit to be with the girls. And also, being a kid with difficulties, I was the object of taunting And I just really desired to pull into myself and to blend into the background. So that thought just kept coming in my mind, and I kept pushing it away. Around sixth grade, I was part of our summer league swimming and diving team. And the diving coach actually would take opportunities to pull me aside, and he would fondle me. He would play with me. At that point, I really didn't think that I was having any difficulties. I mean, I kind of liked the attention because somebody was giving me attention. But when he would do that and seeing therapists about this, in my mind, I would go somewhere else. I didn't like what he was doing to me.
I see. And so in your mind, you kind of disassociated yourself from the situation.
I did.
Yeah.
I did. So I went away in my mind, and I really didn't think he was bothering me until I was, later in life, senior in high school, going into college. I had those reoccurring thoughts. I had this situation with sexual abuse.
But Billy, can I stop you there? When your diving coach was fondling you, did the thought enter your mind that you might be gay?
No.
No, that wasn't a thing for you.
No, not at all, because I would totally dissociate and actually go somewhere else in my mind. Whether it was one of my favorite places to go was like on a beach, watching the waves come in. Mm-hmm. I tried I'm a very visual person. And one way that I've learned to deal with stress is to go somewhere that's very peaceful within my mind.
I see. Because, and that business of disassociating, I've heard that from other people who have experienced some form of childhood trauma or sexual abuse or something like that. It's not uncommon for people to react in that way. But of course, in sixth grade, you wouldn't have known that.
No.
Yeah. No. Did you ever tell anybody about it, Billy? Did you ever tell anybody about that?
When I was in the 12th grade, I did. In the 12th grade, I finally told my mom about it. And she said, I knew something was going on. I couldn't pinpoint it. You didn't say anything. She talking to me. But I just had this intuition that something was going on. Mm-hmm. So I did when I became a senior in high school. The way that I learned to deal with that issue and with the troubled thoughts was, instead of turning to drugs, instead of turning to alcohol, I learned to turn to exercise.
Oh, okay.
So when I was in high school, I joined a AAU, or USS as it later became, swim team. So I'd be up in the morning four times a week, at 4:30, would be in the water swimming at 5:30, swim for an hour and a half, get up, go to school. I was also part of the band. So right after school, we had band rehearsal, whether it be marching band or symphonic band. Had to get out of band early to go back to LSU for swim team practice. And we were in the water for 2 hours, then home for dinner, do homework, unpack the wet clothes, repack my bag for the next day, get ready to do it again. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was so busy, I didn't have a chance to stay in my mind. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's how I dealt with it for a number of years.
Uh-huh. And so when did the thought come to your mind that you were a trans person and that you know that maybe you should become a girl, that this thought that you had at the age of six came back and became some kind of tangible reality for you?
I was a senior in college.
I see.
I fell in love with a young lady that was in my running class at LSU, and falling in love, it blew the door off of my closet, and all of those emotions and everything came out, and I started to have a breakdown.
Wow.
I had to confide in my sister that I was having these thoughts, that God made a mistake, that I'm a girl. And I don't know what to do with those thoughts. I didn't know how to handle them. She told me, well, Billy, I know of a sexuality therapist. I've heard of this therapist. And I will make you an appointment to see her. I was excited about the opportunity because I never shared this thought with absolutely anyone because it was so taboo, so distant. And I hated it. I hated it. I was so confused. So I went to this lady, this therapist in Baton Rouge. I shared my story with her, my journey, my coping mechanisms. And I'm like, my desire is to be normal. I want to be a normal man. I don't want these thoughts. I just want to overcome. Mm-hmm. With the lady that I was in love with, I confided in her exactly what was going on. And that I was having these difficulties. And she told me, I told her, I'm having these difficulties. I think it would be best if we break up. And she told me that she liked me so very much that she did not want to break up. That as long as I was dealing with these issues, working to overcome, that she wanted to stay with me. But there was a caveat. She said, I don't want to be part of this and I don't want to know anything about it. Well, you know, I'm Billy Burleigh. They call me Burleigh for a reason. Action. Okay, that's a joke. but I really thought I was man enough, strong enough to say, I can do this on my own. So I embarked on that journey to do it on my own. And so I also knew that I had to confide what was going on with my family as well. So I told my mom, my dad, and my brothers and sisters, and they were of the same opinion. As long as I was going and working to overcome, they were right there beside me. Mm-hmm. And so I did this for a number of years, Dr. Morris. I was in therapy for about 5 years. And in this process, the lady that I was dating, she and I, we were dating at that point for about five-ish years. And it was to the point where it was like, are we going to go to the next step? Should we break up? What should we do? So we decided to get married. Huge mistake. It's not good to bring a lot of baggage into a marriage. And that's exactly what I did. So I was still struggling. And at this point, starting to act out on some of my thoughts and feelings. I started putting on and experimenting with some makeup. I started experimenting with some dressing. And that wasn't good. Mm-hmm. But also, Dr. Morris, it was at this time that I was so very confused. Went to our school library and tried to start researching what is transgender, what causes transgenderism or gender confusion. And I started reading books, reading journal articles. And the leading theory that I learned at that point was that I had a birth defect. And this birth defect was that in utero, my mind was washed with the wrong hormones. And therefore, I had the brain of a woman, and I was trapped in a male body. Well, to be totally honest, I thought that was hogwash. I'm like, man, that's ridiculous. I really did.
Really? But you grabbed onto it somehow, in spite of thinking it was ridiculous.
There for a while, I rejected it. I rejected it, and I kept looking. There has to be another solution.
Right.
So my path forward at this point, things were getting darker for me. And so I was thinking, you know, electroshock therapy, but that wasn't a good option. Believing what the research that I had in front of me said that I had a birth defect. My mind was that of a woman. I was trapped in a male body. Or suicide.
Whoa.
Somehow I had to deal with my problem. I love my parents. I love my family so very much. then suicide wasn't a good option, because even though that may be a path that would relieve my mental suffering and anguish, it would create a lot of anguish for my family. And yeah. I did not want that for them.
Well, that's really, permit me to say that that's really an admirable thought on your part, and a sign of maturity that you were able to think that through and have it not be just about you, right? But to see the other people that you cared about.
But I also believe that that was also from God saying,
yes,
no, this,
yeah, that's
this
your guardian angel.
An option.
That's your guardian angel talking. I mean, you know, from, yes. from me in my Catholic background. You know, that was your guardian angel pulling you back from the brink there, you know?
Yes. So going forward, I did get married, but that marriage did not last very long. It uh-huh. lasted 3 years before uh-huh. The lady I was married to and I, we got a divorce because I couldn't overcome. She wouldn't help me and I struggled.
Uh-huh.
Then a little bit later on, I was in a different town, and Dr. Morris, because of my difficulties, I never consummated my marriage, even after 3 years.
Is that right?
Yes. Well. So I became sexually mischievous, and I thought that if I were to have sex and experience sex from the perspective of a male perspective, this would help me in overcoming my problems.
I see.
But actually, God's word is sex, you should wait for marriage. And I just fell more into a bigger trap, more into bondage, wanted more. And on this journey, I actually, one of the a lady I was with, she became pregnant. And I got to tell you, it was about at that point that I finally decided, okay, I need to live and I need to live life. The books, the research are telling me that I need to change. I confided in my therapist and she said, Billy, I knew that you would come to this decision one day. I did not want to push you, but I knew you would reach this. She gave me a letter to go see a doctor to start on hormone therapy.
So wait, let me make sure I get the timeline here. So you became a father. Your friend was pregnant.
Actually, I did not become a father, unfortunately, because in my turmoil, she tried to seek reassurance from me that I'd be there. And yeah. I did not provide that reassurance. She yeah. sought reassurance from her parents that somebody would be there for her. But the word that she got back from her parents was, get rid of this freak's baby.
Wow.
And that's what her stepdad told her. So they told her, encouraged her to get an abortion. And I didn't know what to do. I was the one that drove her and her mother to the abortion clinic.
Wow.
I sat in the waiting room as they called her back, and I was just in tears. I tell you what, it's an awful, awful process. It's awful being in the waiting room while you know that your child is being basically killed. No, basically about it being killed.
Yeah.
Everybody else was in the waiting room reading, napping, watching TV. It's a bad place.
Yeah.
And then after she came back, I mean, at that point, I wanted to try to go back and stop the process. I didn't know if I could. I was scared. And on my journey, I have a child in heaven.
Right, right. Yeah. You are a father.
I am a father.
You were a father. Your child did not come to be born, but yeah, you have a child and you have a child in heaven. That's right.
I do.
Yeah. So wow. Yeah. And you know what? So now layered on top of all the stuff that you have to deal with, you've got post-abortion trauma, which is a real thing for men as well as for women, but it's something we very seldom talk about in our society. So you had layers and layers of stuff to deal with there. Yeah.
I did. You know, all this time I was praying. God,
wow,
change me take my problems away, change me, make me a girl. My prayer at night was to, you know, transform me into a girl when I wake up. I don't want these problems. Help me deal with these problems. But all this time I was taking and the actions myself. In other words, I was in the driver's seat all this time. So I went on hormone therapy.
And how old were you? By this time, how old were you, Billy?
About 30.
You were about 30. 30. Okay.
This was this was about 1995, 96. Then I was on hormone therapy for a number of years, started dressing. And then I, with the encouragement and help of a lady, I went through all the surgeries.
So were you with the same therapist this whole time, Billy?
Yes.
Same therapist that you met at LSU?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I was. And you got to forgive me because sharing this, some of the emotions and things come back. My thoughts go astray. So please forgive me in that.
No problem.
And I scheduled a surgery for a penile inversion. Was actually the surgery to create a man-made artificial vagina. Also to have a brow shave and an Adam's apple shave at the same time to try to feminize myself. The surgery didn't go well. During the surgery, I had a significant amount of bleeding. Within my artificial vagina, there was a lot of gauze that was packed in there. But with all the bleeding, more gauze was shoved in and a sandbag was placed on my abdomen to try to create some pressure to stop the bleeding. I had a blood infusion. I was given some blood. I was given
transfusion.
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 Yeah, transfusion. And then I was given a number of bags of plasma as well. But by God's hand, the bleeding did stop. And the two-week stay that was planned for the hospital turned into a three-week stay. And then many months later, about 4, 5, 6 months later, I had to go back for a part two of that surgery. So my money was low, and I went to that surgery alone, by myself. The first surgery, I had family.
Oh, okay.
The next surgery, I had nobody. And my sordid affairs, I got married again, Dr. Morris. I was never attracted to men. I was always attracted to women. I had these difficult thoughts in my mind. I had this confusion. So I was very confused. And right before my first surgery, I got married to a woman. And she said she just wanted to be with me. She wasn't a lesbian, but in the course of everything I'd done, we had to present as two lesbians.
I see.
So are you tracking that? I know this is very confusing.
Yeah, it is a little confusing, but she must have had some confusion of her own. But I think it's wise to not talk about her story because this is your story. It's confusing. But you were confused. This is what happens.
I was confused and I was trying to survive and trying to do anything and everything that I could to try to survive and make life normal. But with everything that I was doing to try to make life normal, things became even unnormal.
Uh-huh.
I was trying to find that peace between my body and the mind.
Uh-huh.
But I had a male appearance. Testosterone does such has such an effect on the human body that it's bone altering. And in my surgeries, I tried to change my appearance from male to female. And I was fairly successful because I got to a point where people were calling me ma'am, she, her. I even had voice surgery to alter my voice. I had rhinoplasty. I had a number of other surgeries to try to help me along. But in doing all of this, 7 years into this process, presenting as female, as a lesbian, I had more problems at that point than I had at the beginning of this transformation, this journey. And I was calling
to God.
Were
they the same? Were they the same problems magnified, or were there a whole series of new problems that you're experiencing after 7 years of attempting this?
The same problems were there, but I had a whole set of new problems.
I see. Okay, right.
And I could not confide in anybody about my childhood, my past, because if I'm presenting as female, well, my past is totally male.
Right. I was a little boy once. Right. That's the one part of being a woman. And you know, that has always struck me, if I could say this as a woman. It's always struck me when someone like Bruce Jenner talks about being a woman and whatnot. No matter what you do, you can never have the experience of being a little girl. You know, that part of your reality is never going to change. And so, therefore, there's a kind of disorientation, you could say, between your past and your present. And so that sounds like that was a part of what you were dealing with also, that you couldn't, that's like that was forbidden territory. Somehow your childhood was cut off from you.
It was. And also another forbidden territory was making new friends and getting into an intimate friendship, below the surface friendship with anybody. Because when you go below the surface and you become friends with people, what do? You talk about your past, your experiences, your problems. And by no way, no how was I going to share my past, my problems, my difficulties with other people. That would divide a relationship. So yeah. I had a whole new set of problems at that point.
I see. And so you were still with the woman. How long were you married?
We were married about 7 years.
I see.
All of the time that I identified as a woman, we were married. But when I was making the decision, talking to God, I'm like, okay, God, I'm thinking about changing. The books told me if I changed my body to match my mind, I would find peace.
Right.
And that was that. I'm finding out that was a lie.
Yeah.
And I need to draw closer to you. So the more I drew closer to God, the worse our relationship got. My relationship with the lady I was married to the point where she asked me for a divorce. And I couldn't stop it.
Right.
So, Dr. Morris, I got to another low point in my life where suicide was a big option again. I had done everything within my powers, within my capabilities to do with the therapist, with the books, with all the research I read, said that I needed to do to find happiness, to find peace. But I found more misery, more turmoil, more difficulties. Where was the way out? And so in my Jeep on a street somewhere, I had to stop and I had to pour my heart out to God. I was bawling. I had water coming from my eyes, fluid coming from my nose. I was just calling out to God saying, I am a mess. I don't know the way out. I give my life to you. I give all my problems to you. I don't know where to turn, what to do. I'm out of options. And it was almost, I heard a voice within my mind say, now I have some clay to deal with.
Whoa. Whoa. Literally? Right. Did you literally hear a voice, Billy?
I didn't hear it with my ears, but inside my mind and my heart, yes.
Yeah.
Now I have some clay to deal with. Up until that point, I was trying to figure out my own path, and I didn't give anything over to God. This is where things started really happening, Dr. Morse. At that point, I needed help with my finances, and I heard on the radio that at a church I used to attend back in college, the chapel on the campus at LSU, They were going to have a program to help you learn about your finances. I'm like, I'm signing up for that. Well, the man and wife that was hosting that program I went to said, hey, we have a small group that meets here on Sunday mornings before service. Billy, why don't you join us? It's called the Bodybuilders. Well, I was still using exercise as my means of coping. And I thought, hey, you know, the Bodybuilders, that's what I'm into. So I think I'm going to join that group.
Were you still presenting as a woman at that point?
I was.
And you called yourself Billy, like Billy Burke, the actress or whatever.
Right. Well, yes, because my nickname has always been Billy.
Yeah. So okay, makes sense.
My male name is Billy, I-L-L-Y. My female name was Billy, I-E.
Right.
And later I just went back to the Y.
Right. So anyway, they invited you a Bible study.
They did. And when I got there, I was still presenting as a female. I had my makeup on, my earrings, my hair was down halfway down my back, had my blouse. And the Bodybuilders was a group of middle-aged to older people that was studying and going through the Bible and seeking God and his direction. And when I get into the class, it wasn't a lot of people who were working out physically.
They were that was the image you had. I get it. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so listen, I got to tell you. God has a sense of humor. That was his joke on you, just luring you in with some bait that he knew was going to work for you.
But, you know, there's so much more to the story because the very first, when I got there, they just transitioned out of an old study and they're transitioning into a new study. And the topic of the study, the very first thing, the gentleman said, have you done something you regret?
Oh my gosh. Okay. All right.
I'm like, Holy Spirit, really?
Really? Okay, you can believe what... All right, listen, all of our non-religious friends who are watching here, because I know we have some non-religious friends, right? You guys can believe what you want to believe. Me and Billy, we're going to believe what we want to believe. Continue, Billy.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, the wonderful That's hilarious.
Thing, the wonderful Sorry. Thing is, and the facilitator, towards the end, he said that when he was younger... He stole something from a store. Years later, he had to go back and tell the store manager, confess what he did, and to pay for that item. And then he opened up the floor to everybody else in the class to share anything that they have done that they regret. And the Holy Spirit was telling me, go ahead, Billy, go ahead and tell them, okay, I'm presenting as a woman, I'm transgender, I just got into this class. I don't know these people. And the Holy Spirit is telling me to share everything about me with these people. And I'm like, no way. So I'm having an argument inside. After class, we walked to the building next door. And the greeter at the building, she was a wonderful younger lady. And she's like, hi, I haven't seen you here before. You must be new. And I'm like, well, yes and no. I am new. I'm just coming back to Baton Rouge. But as a student at LSU, I used to come to church here. She's like, oh, so you grew up in Baton Rouge? Yes. What high school did you attend to? To back up a moment, I went to Catholic High in Baton Rouge, which is an all-boys school. If I shared with her that I went to Catholic High, I instantly out myself.
Right.
And so I said, I went to a Catholic school. And she's like, oh, did you go to St. Joseph's Academy? I said, around there. I took the church notes, the pamphlet out of her hand and ran into church. And the Holy Spirit was saying, you see, Billy, you're living a lie.
You
cannot
yeah.
talk to people. You can't. I got these problems. You can't share things. And the Holy Spirit was talking with me the entire beginning of that week. So I had to call the facilitator up around Wednesday, the middle of the week, and say, you know that question that you asked, could you revisit it? And so he didn't say anything that he got a phone call, but the following week he did revisit that question in a wonderful way, just opened it up to everybody. And I had to confess that I was on this journey, that I was really born male and that I was transgender. And I was totally expecting for the church to kick me out, to say change and then come back. But they did an absolutely wonderful thing, and they loved me where I was.
Mm-hmm.
They embraced me, and they welcomed me. And then I had dinner with another couple that was in the group, and they wanted to hear my story. And they knew that God was working on me.
Right.
And all that time, they were praying for me.
Yep, yep.
So
the fact that you had gotten that far and were willing to speak it meant that you were you were in a substantially different place than you would have been had you come in and said, "I'm transgender, get over it, accept me the way I am." That's not what you were presenting at all. You were presenting a kind of you were putting your heart out there. Yeah, the whole painful
yes.
journey of it.
And I was seeking. I was seeking. Right. I was humble, and I was seeking, and I was like, oh man. And I believe they, in their hearts, in their mind, they sensed it, and
right.
they embraced me.
Right, right.
Well, God wasn't done with me yet, because mm-hmm. I was diving into the Bible. I was reading the Word. We were talking about the Word in our small group. And another couple in the group invited me to their Wednesday evening gathering, where they did some studying as well. I didn't want to push it at that point. I'm glad to be accepted here. And I was like, yeah. Oh, man, I don't want to be rejected. But the Holy Spirit put on my heart and my mind that I needed to accept the offer from this gentleman. And I know he doesn't mind me mentioning his name, Larry Spencer. He and his wife just opened up their house to me, and they brought me in. And so I went to their small group on Wednesday evening, and you know, the exact same thing happened to me again. They had just finished a study, and they were opening up another study, and they were diving into a book, Reclaiming Surrendered Ground by Jim Logan, and it's a book on spiritual warfare.
Oh.
And I'm like, I never heard of this topic.
Wow.
This would be interesting. So as we dive into the book, I learn that not all of our thoughts are our thoughts. That sounds confusing, and it was very confusing to me. But I learned, and the Bible very clearly demonstrates this, that our thoughts can come from God, ourselves, and the devil.
Right, right.
And just very quickly, Matthew 15, we see an example of God giving Peter the thought. Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do you say I am?" And Peter mm-hmm. says, "Jesus, you're the Son of God." And Jesus says, "Well, very good, but that wasn't your thought. That thought came to you from right. my Father."
Right, right, right.
We can see just two paragraphs later, Jesus says, "I'm going to the I'm going to be killed." And Peter says, "No way, Lord." Jesus says, "Get behind me, comma, Satan."
Satan. Mm-hmm.
He was talking to Satan. In other words, he was telling Peter, be very careful, because that thought actually came from the devil. Also, in 1 Chronicles, chapter 21, verse 1, we see King David. The devil gave him a thought to count his fighting men.
Mm-hmm.
And his general said, "King David, don't do this. This is not good." At that time, God was fighting their battles. But if it was by the king's own resources, then it would be, you would want to know the number of your fighting men. But if you're fighting and walking by faith, then you're relying on God and you don't
right.
need to know
right.
that. So I learned, and you know, I came out of that study and I'm like, Billy, you big fool, you have been deceived. The thought that you had was not your thought. The thought yeah. that God made a mistake, I was a girl, was not my thought. That was a thought, a fiery dart from the adversary.
Yeah, that is not a godly thought. And I want to pause on that right now, because this is a thought that a lot of children are being fed, children much younger than you. But, you know, when you went through all these decisions, you were 30 years old, you know, little kids who are already doing magical thinking, you know, who don't have a mature thought process. They're being told you were born in the wrong body, which is, when you think about it, a very scary thought for a child. That you were born in the wrong body. That is not a godly thought. And your experience proves that, and because it's not a real thought. God does not deal in fantasy like that. God's about reality, and God's not going to feed you something like that. So
he does it. And you know, the more I studied about spiritual warfare and that what God's word says, and he has so much to say about our mind.
Yep.
He says to take our thoughts captive to the obedience of him. Also, he says that we need to renew our mind, Romans 12, verses yep. 1 and 2.
Right. And you know, Billy, that thought of spiritual warfare, I just want to say, since you went to Catholic high school, that has been always a deep part of the Catholic spiritual tradition. The spiritual warfare is a real thing. You know, I mean, that's always been, but this is one of the things that has been lost in modern times. And so therefore people become sitting ducks, because all of the resources that we, at one time, everybody understood this was a possible mm-hmm. thing, you know, that you could be misled, you know, that the thoughts that you have, you don't give equal weight to all of your thoughts, you know, this is not modern psychology here. This is very, very old, very sophisticated, actually, spiritual understanding of the real world. Who did you now? So you had your Bible study friends here. Where was your birth family through all of this? By this time, you must have been divorced from your female wife, with whom yeah. you've been living, sort of like presenting as lesbians. What about your? Where was the rest of your family through all of this, Billy?
Right beside me.
Is that so? Yeah, tell us yes. about that. Tell us about that.
My mom and dad, my family, by no means wanted me to go down this road.
Uh-huh.
But they loved me so much that they wanted to walk with me and pray for me all throughout this journey and pray for God to bring reality
yeah.
into my mind
yeah.
to help me. So as I transitioned... And I got pictures of me with my sister, mm-hmm. And her baby, mm-hmm. and they were right beside me. And my mom made it very clear to the rest of my family, my siblings, that we don't like what Billy is going through, but we are going to walk beside Billy through this. Mm-hmm. And if you do not like it, she asked my brothers and sisters to respectfully hold their tongue.
Yeah.
So they were right with me, and that made a huge difference for me.
Yes. And so when it came time, so somewhere in here, you're going to tell us that you detransitioned. Let's go to that part of the story. If we can, you know, tell people what that was like for you and what it was like for your family.
So after learning about the spiritual warfare and that I've been duped, I've been deceived, and that I had these problems, I had this thought, I need to detransition. I need to go back to my birth gender. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's exactly what I did. I was actually working at NASA, the Marshall Space Force Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama at this time. And so I had to tell my bosses what was going on. Now that God had his hand on me, the transition from female back to male was very easy. I had the support of my bosses. I was a contractor, so I had my contract boss and my customer boss.
Right.
And I had the support of my coworkers. And
wow.
So I started to transition back.
Uh-huh.
And in the transitioning back, I met my present wife, Rachel. We enjoyed doing triathlons. I was part of Christian athletes, endurance. We did triathlons, and we had a meeting at my house. and her daughter, and she actually joined our meeting that night. She heard about us at a triathlon, and that's where I met her. And we went out for coffee on a date. And then after that, we went out on a real date, kind of went for pizza, movie. I have to be upfront with people about my past. And it was at that very time that I had to share with her all about my past. And her response to me was, "Billy, this is great. I like you. Let's be friends."
Before we go any further, when you were competing in a triathlon, were you competing as a woman or competing as a man?
Woman.
Okay.
I was competing as a woman, and I have a lot to say about women competing in women's sports.
Let's finish your story. We've been talking for a while. Let's finish your story, and there'll be other opportunities. By the way, I think our meeting each other is a whole God thing. I'm just going to put that out there. But anyway, so there you were transitioning back, and you met this nice lady, and she's like, okay, whatever, we're going to be friends. And did you have medical problems transitioning back? Were there medical issues?
No, because I went off estrogen, and then I got on a testosterone.
I see.
And the testosterone started to deepen my voice again. My muscles started to come back. And so I really had no difficulties in transitioning back to male. I altered my body. I have scars all over my body.
Yeah.
Because of what I have done. So that couldn't be reversed.
Right. But the fact that you transitioned, you were already a mature man when you transitioned. So some of the problems that the younger people are having as they detransition have to do with their puberty not being fully complete.
These hormones, these purity blockers, these chemicals have a drastic effect on children and on their bodies and their minds. And I think it is more difficult for them to transition back to their birth gender than it would be for me I did.
Yeah. Okay. So let's go back, finish the story. You met this lovely lady, you were friends, and you're married to her now.
We've been married now for 11 years. We got married in 2011, and it's been wonderful, but I got to confess that there was a period of time in there that I started backsliding. I understood that there was a battle, the spiritual aspect, but I also kept having these thoughts that, "Billy, you're an abomination. God can't love you." I was trying to take these thoughts captive, but that's when Dr. Neil Anderson and Freedom in Christ came into my life, because Freedom in Christ is a discipleship ministry. There's so much that Jesus has done for us, his provisions for us to stand in these daily battles.
Right.
And it was then when I actually started to dive deeper into the Bible to understand all the ramifications of what Jesus has done for us, that I was able to fully overcome all of my struggles. And Dr. Morse, I am happy to tell you, I am completely 100% free. Mm-hmm. I am aware of the battle. I am aware of the spiritual struggles and what Jesus has done for us. And I'm so thankful.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you know, there are so many points in your story that I think people watching can connect with. And I hope that people will connect with, you know, I'm thinking about your family and the therapists and all that, the whole journey that all of them went through. Think back to that earlier stage, that earlier Billy, you know, when you were struggling and you were thinking, gee, transitioning is the right thing to do. Is there, looking back on it, is there something other people could have done or said that would have been helpful to you at that time?
You know, yes.
Looking back on it, what could people have done that would have been helpful?
To help me understand that we are in spiritual battles and that not all of our thoughts are our thoughts. Mm-hmm. We do not have to accept them. Mm-hmm. We do not need to dwell on them. Uh-huh. We can actually reject the thoughts that we know that are not our thoughts. For instance, there's a lot of professors, there's a lot of teachers that are trying to teach and do and teach false teachings. But if we know the truth that the sky is blue and somebody tries to teach us that the sky is green, it's like, oh no, that's not right.
Right.
You instantly reject it.
Right.
So somebody would have helped me at that point understand that the battle that is going in my mind is just not my mind. There's something else that is going on. And I don't have to accept the thought that God made a mistake, I'm a girl.
Right. Right.
That's totally false.
Right there. That was the crux of it right there. That if you had had more support on that thought, right, that would have been really helpful to you. And I want to give a hats off to your family. It sounds like your family did, all things considered, the best that could have been done given where you were, you know. Yeah. because I have people reach out to me all the time. What are we going to do? How are we going to handle it? You know, so on and so forth. And, you know, in one respect, you remind me of my friend Charlene Cothran, with whom I interviewed, I don't know what, very early on in the Dr. J Show, I interviewed with her. She lived as a lesbian for many years. And she was delivered from it in her own way, you know, and you can still watch that video. It's one of our most popular videos. But one of the things she said was that her mother never gave up on her. Her mother never gave up on her. Her mother knew all along. Her mother was praying for her the whole time. And she says that in her video, you know, that you just don't want to give up on your loved ones who are struggling. There's so much in the environment that is steering people wrongly that you don't want to be, you know, you don't want to pile on.
Right. You know, we're in trouble. We're having difficulties and we're confused, but having somebody walk with us through these struggles is huge. And to pray for us as right. well. I am a big believer in the power of prayer, and praying really helps, because that's what that bodybuilder group was doing for me through the number of years. I was with them 2 years in that group before I got transferred to another job elsewhere. They were praying for me. And even after I left the group, mm-hmm. they were praying for me. Mm-hmm. And when I transitioned back to male, then they confided to me that we've been praying for this all along.
Yeah, right. Right, 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 right. But they weren't blasting you with it. The point is they weren't blasting you with it. Yeah, yeah. But but to be fair, you weren't blasting them with it either.
Yep. And I'd also just very briefly mention, you know, the church accepted me. They walked with me, but they also did not let me participate in any area of responsibility within the church. They knew that I was still living a sinful lifestyle, that this was not of God. Marriage is between a man and a woman, and God doesn't make mistakes in the body that he puts us in. They loved me where I was, but they made it clear to me that, you know, grow before you try to help other people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that at that time, I did not fully understand, but in retrospect, I now do understand how they loved me.
Yes. Yes. And they did. Yes, that's right. I think that's really wise. It sounds like they walked that line very well, in part because they were clear about their doctrine. They were not the type of church that is so seeker friendly that they water down the doctrine. Right. Mm-hmm. Because as soon as you do that, you can't help. Right.
That's right. That's right. God was in the church and right. they were helping me.
Right, right. Well, Billy Burleigh, this is a great place to stop. Your story is heartwarming. I'll tell you something. I'm not going to lie. I thought this is going to be a heartbreaking story. And in a way it is, but it's also a heartwarming story. So I really appreciate your candor. I respect your journey very much. And I'm grateful that you took the time to be with us. And all of you followers of the Ruth Institute, if this video has blessed you, please, by all means, share this with people. The little button's right down there. It's very easy for you to share. It's very easy for you to subscribe to our channel where you can find other great content like this and to hit that little bell so you'll receive the notifications every time we bring up something that will be this powerful. You know, I don't know how we're going to ever top this video, Billy, but we have a lot of great stuff on this channel. So thank you so much for being part of the Dr. J Show today.
Thank you for having me.